Every corpse tells a story. The hangman in Martinez tells a mystery. Scars from battles, wars of the past. The dead body on the boardwalk tells a drunken farce. The corpse of Revachol itself, well, Revachol is an unmitigated tragedy. An atrocity, really. It's muddy roads, it's rundown shacks, it's rust-colored water, it's hopeless masses, bullet holes in the wall, scars from a long, bloody history. Events of the past etched into our present reality. Hello and welcome to Nightmare Masterclass. My name is David Stockdale. I'll be your host on this excursion into the dark unknown. This is the first part of a two-part series in which I analyze the game Disco Elysium.
What are you on about again? Is this that YouTube thing you're doing? Nightmare Masterclass? What are you a master of, exactly? A master of farts?
You know, the sense of revolutionary art as it was espoused by Brecht was to instill the sense that things one might think are natural are actually historical.
You guys really got to shut up now.
All right, where was I?
Disco Elysium is a single-player role-playing game developed by an Estonian game studio called ZAUM. It started as a project known as No Truce for the Furies. The game was initially intended to be a much smaller project, but it ballooned into something much bigger. The first thing I feel compelled to do is make it clear just how much time and effort went into the production of this game. Disco Elysium employs a number of conventions commonly associated with tabletop RPGs, traditional paper and pen games, that is. It's set in a fictional universe first fleshed out in Robert Kurvitz's novel Sacred and Terrible Air. One particularly novel feature of Disco Elysium is its use of a mechanic known as the Thought Cabinet, a highly innovative feature accompanied by some really breathtaking illustrations. During my first campaign, it really took me some time to get a firm grasp on just how this mechanic worked exactly. Kurvitz himself described the Thought Cabinet as a feature you are beginning to suspect is going to take down the entire video game studio. He envisioned it as an inventory for thoughts, as opposed to the murder hobo paradigm, his words, whereby the player simply kills people and takes their stuff. Disco Elysium is considerably more thoughtful and story-driven. It's a very unconventional game in that respect. Let's talk about the story. Disco Elysium takes place in the midst of a major strike by the dock workers of Revachol, the former capital of a mysterious realm known as Elysium. Revachol is the site of a failed communist revolution which took place 50 years before the start of the game. You play a detective known as Harry Dubois, although Harry has a difficult time remembering exactly who he is at the start of the game due to a prolonged bender. You are met by Lieutenant Kim Kitsuragi, your partner, an astute gentleman who relays that you are in Martinez to investigate a murder. So, you start sleuthing around. The investigation seems to indicate that the victim was lynched. Upon arrival, his body is still hung up on a tree. A militant branch of the Union known as the Hardy Boys claims responsibility for the killing. Although there seem to be holes in their story from the get-go, the strike is met with a counter-protest by scabs. This is eventually revealed to be an astroturfed campaign carried out by a private security contractor. Mercenaries is probably the more accurate terminology here, hired by a company called Wild Pines. As it turns out, the victim was the leader of said mercenaries. And then there's Classier. Classier assumes the role of the femme fatale, as it were. Titus, the leader of the Hardy Boys, claims that Classier was raped by the victim, although she quickly refutes that upon additional questioning. According to her, they just, you know, partied. Sex and drugs, as one does. In fact, you kind of get the sense that she actually misses him. You know, that mercenary dude she just went on a drinking binge with. Yeah, she misses that guy. I guess it's totally normal in this world to be low-key hooking up with the leader of a fucking death squad. As it turns out, Classier is the person who initially called the RCM to report the crime. She got sick of the locals messing with the body, which is fair enough, I guess. The remaining mercenaries dispense with the pleasantries and engage in a standoff with the Hardy Boys. Their goal is to circumvent legal procedures and simply murder the militant wing of the Union as punishment for murdering their leader. You are compelled to intervene first by attempting to de-escalate the situation, and then, when that fails, you and your trusty partner end up in a firefight, which, if you play your cards right, results in the death of said mercenaries. Eventually, you learn that the victim was shot. Your investigation leads to an island, the former site of a communist stronghold. As it turns out, a former commissar named Yosef from Old Revachol remains on the island. Yosef is still dedicated to the cause. He admits to sniping the victim, his motives being a combination of resent due to the capitalist coalition's hold on Revachol and jealousy due to the victim's relationship with Classier, who he has creepily admired from afar. Subsequently, the murder, an individual act, was dressed up as a collective act, a lynching. The Hardy Boys did so in an effort to protect one of their members. A collective act dilutes responsibility such that any one particular individual can't be held responsible. After the confession, you are confronted by a cryptid, a mythical insect-like creature known as the Insolidian Phasmid. The Phasmid has emitted some kind of poison in the air, causing Yosef to become delusional. Dubois learns that he had initially arrived with a crew, which he summarily dismissed, claiming that they were cramping his style. In all likelihood, they were just trying to get him to, you know, stop drinking so much. Additionally, it is revealed that Dubois' mental breakdown and subsequent alcohol binge was spurred by his wife's departure. Although I suspect that Harry's emotional problems started prior to that event and possibly are related to various traumatic events he experienced as an officer of the RCM. Towards the very end of the game, Harry has a rendezvous with his former partner, Jean Vicamare. They reflect on his handling of the case, and that's that. Disco Elysium has been heralded by various leftists, surely due to its weighty class-based themes. That's what initially attracted my attention. I mean, I knew it was going to be good based on what people were saying, but please believe me when I say the game exceeded my expectations in ways I couldn't possibly have fathomed. There's a general openness to the work that gives the impression of a complex, detailed world rife with murder, intrigue, and class warfare. But where the magic really happens is within the mind of our protagonist. His various thoughts, impulses, and emotions are sometimes conflicting, sometimes contingent upon prior decisions made in the game, and perhaps most significantly, Dubois' thought processes to a great extent mimic the type of stream of consciousness that can be observed in various literary works, foremost of which I would say is the modernist literature of Joyce, Faulkner, and Woolf. Dubois' thoughts give the impression of various drives competing within the mind for influence and control. For instance, after you obtain the keys for a trash compactor, a drive known as Inland Empire, possibly my favorite drive, warns, "Don't, maybe you shouldn't," while a drive known as Interfacing mockingly responds, "Maybe you shouldn't, of course you should." Interfacing, not surprisingly, likes to interface with things. At another point, Volition casually informs you that you can't trust any of your senses, much less electrochemistry of all things. Predictably, electrochemistry desperately attempts to convince you that he's not compromised, but Volition says he's the most compromised. This would make sense considering the fact that electrochemistry is always trying to get you to drink and smoke and take fucking speed, so yeah. The distinct literary nature of this work is not surprising in consideration of the fact that it takes place in a fictional world first established in a science fiction novel. But Disco Elysium really is something else. Most victims in these mystery thriller joints tend to be young women, like, you know, Laura Palmer or the sex worker in True Detective. But Kurvitz wanted to do something a little bit different with this story. The victim in this game is a middle-aged dude who is, in many ways, like the protagonist. When you harness your extrasensory detective abilities to speak to the victim, he identifies himself as a killer, a motherfucker, and a killer. There's an uncomfortable symmetry there, considering the victim is eventually revealed to be the leader of a death squad sent in to put a stop to the dock workers' strike. At one point in the game, Harry has a dream in which he is in the place of the victim, hung up on that tree. And strangely, there's a disco ball above his head. Needless to say, there's a whole lot to analyze here, and I assure you, we will be pulling on that thread soon. Another thing I really appreciate about this game is its socio-political subtext, which is prevalent all throughout the game. I also like how the personal is intertwined with the political all throughout Disco Elysium. For starters, let's talk about Dubois, the protagonist. I mean, the guy is a middle-aged alcoholic who doesn't even have enough money to pay his hotel bill at the start of the game. Decidedly, this isn't a power fantasy. You're not an all-powerful, semi-godlike figure who mows down enemies with ease. You're just a dude who occasionally tries to do his job, which, by the way, is a pretty terrible job. The world is stunning in terms of the amount of detail provided, which I guess makes sense considering the plethora of material to draw from in the book. Not only is Elysium's rich history regaled to the player one prompt at a time, so too is the world's philosophical scene given a fair amount of attention. At one point in the game, a character named Liliane, who I swear I'm gonna score a date with eventually. Well, anyway, she suggests that they have a funeral for the detective's crashed motor carriage. She says, "Our things are part of our life world. They're made with human sweat, and they share human history. We should care about them as we care about humans, to some extent at least." The detective's conceptualization, another drive, chimes in. Life world? Someone's been reading up on last century Gottwaldian philosophers. But this Gottwald isn't the game's philosophical mascot. That honor goes to a character named Krasmazov. Clearly a Karl Marx type figure in this world, or maybe like a combination between Marx and Lenin. The deification of certain individuals in Disco Elysium is yet another interesting historical twist. A philosophical school of thought known as humanism appears to be highly influential, in particular references to a figure known as the Innocents recur throughout the work. In the world of Disco Elysium, an Innocence is a kind of living personification of a particular historical epoch. You can think of them as a type of secular pope with complete and total political power. The title of Innocence seems to me to be a satirical commentary on the great man theory of history, the idea that certain individuals drive history through their, you know, greatness or whatever. The detective's encyclopedia says, "An innocence is infallible. The decisions made by one are not decisions. They are inevitabilities. What would have happened anyway, only accelerated, packed into decades instead of centuries. An innocence is a continuous, compressed event, a sacred human being. It is an honor and a glory to live when one is in office." A book refers to Dolores Day as the greatest innocence. The detective's encyclopedia provides additional information on Dolores Day after the detective happens upon the Dolorian Church of Humanity, or rather, as it's referred to by the Crabman, the Church of the Mother of Silence. According to the encyclopedia, Day is the innocence of humanism, internationalism, and the welfare state, and, quote, "perhaps the most famous human being ever to have lived," end quote. The encyclopedia says, "There is something lonely, paranoid, and even terrifying that people seldom mention but feel when they think of her." Conceptualization concludes that this subtle terror is indeed part of Day's iconography. The encyclopedia goes on to say that one of the men in Day's Secret Service, presumably an agency set up to protect her, eventually murdered her. He claimed that Day was not human. She was something else. So my question is, was Dolores Day some kind of time traveler? Is it possible? Your encyclopedia relays an intriguing plot thread, something that had walked in our midst, watching us stumble for hundreds, if not thousands of years, until it decided to interfere in the course of history. We were supposed to come up with this ourselves, the man was reported to have screamed at the innocents. The game's characterization develops very gradually over the course of the story. In particular, the relationship between Dubois and his partner made the game a very rich experience. There are times in the game when it seems like you've let Kim down or disappointed him in some way, but there are also times when it seems as though your unorthodox approach really impresses him. Kim comes to develop not just a begrudging respect for Dubois, but eventually, it would seem, also a kind of admiration. I guess it's kind of like a dystopian twist on the buddy cop movie in that respect. While we're on that topic, one of your drives is Esprit de Corps. This one pertains to cop culture. After a long divergence about Joyce Messier's boat, Kim says, "I'm enjoying this part of the interview. It has so little to do with the murder we're investigating." Your Esprit de Corps chimes in. "I really do," the lieutenant thinks. "Is she thrown off yet?" He's looking at the woman, assessing her. Non sequiturs create the sense of a much broader world. At one point, your Esprit de Corps chimes in. Somewhere in Jamrock North, a small woodshed behind Rosencrantz Row, Lieutenant Nick Feuerbach puts his hands to the chest of a small corpse, no larger than a monkey. It's raining outside, light drizzle. There's darkness in the shed. Your rhetoric chimes in. The engines stop. The West Revachalian industrial base was dismantled after the war. Now extinguished coke furnaces dot the landscape, a landscape bespoiled by industry. To which one of the options to reply is, "I don't see the problem. Revachal moved on to a service industry. Get with the times, yo." And then there's just the small interpersonal details that add a certain richness to the work. The player has the potential to form unlikely connections. For instance, you can become friends with Lena, the cryptozoologist's wife, a troubled kid named Kuno, and of course there's Annette, the bookstore owner's daughter. Another great thing, certain morbid details just make the game for me. Like, for instance, the victim's ceramic armor. Due to 7 days worth of decomposition, the victim's highly advanced boots have fused to his skin. And so you can initiate a whole side quest to get the things off of his body. But enough with the gushing. Let's get to the serious business of ideological analysis. There's a distinctly literary quality to Disco Elysium, which suggests to me that there's more at play in this work than one might expect upon an initial playthrough. In order to bring this mysterious substance to the surface, I'll be using an interpretive model fleshed out by Frederick Jameson in his book, The Political Unconscious, Narrative as a Socially Symbolic Act. I'm going to do a more detailed primer on Jameson in the next installment of my podcast, Nightmare Tonight. Yeah, that's right. In case you haven't heard, I'm a podcast guy now. Anyway, stay tuned for that. Jameson first came to my attention by way of Mark Fisher, a writer I've mentioned a few times on this channel. It's clear that Jameson is one of Fisher's major influences. Specifically, Jameson is one of the sources credited for the now infamous saying, "It is easier to imagine an end to the world than an end to capitalism." This notion essentially serves as the basis for a key concept in Fisher's work, capitalist realism, the dominant ideology of our time. I believe it's very possible this saying is now coming to fruition in literal terms. We have uprisings around the country in response to the murder of George Floyd by the Minneapolis police, and the U.S. government has responded by imposing curfews and brutally suppressing protests. This comes in the midst of a deadly pandemic, with unemployment numbers rivaled only by the Great Depression, and frontline workers now having to choose between their livelihoods and exposure to a deadly virus. It would seem that the contradictions of late capitalism are now coming to a head. With this in mind, one simple question occurs to me. Is it possible that the era of capitalist realism is over? Have we overcome the hegemonic view that there is no alternative to capitalism? More on that later. For now, I want to discuss Frederick Jameson's approach to artistic and literary interpretation as it is spelled out in Political Unconscious. Jameson plainly states that the imperative, always historicize, is the moral of the book. Clearly, history is absolutely central in Jameson's worldview. In Political Unconscious, Jameson is arguing for the primacy of political interpretations of literary texts. His goal is not to put forth a new method as simply another option in the myriad of already existing interpretive frameworks, like the psychoanalytic method, the formal method, the archetypal, post-colonial, etc. Rather, what Jameson is attempting to articulate is, quote, the absolute horizon of all reading and all interpretation. This is an ambitious claim, to be sure, but Jameson is a scrutinous thinker, and I think you'll find there's a lot of merit to this interpretive model. Jameson says that Marxism is the ultimate semantic precondition required for other interpretive methods to be entirely coherent. However, it's important to note that other methods may have sectoral validity in this framework. In other words, these methods often make sense within a contained area, what Jameson sometimes calls a locality. For instance, it's entirely conceivable that a feminist or post-structural unpacking of a certain text might prove exceedingly fruitful and revealing in certain respects. It's just that, according to Jameson, such interpretations need to be cast against the broad scope of historical development in order to be completely intelligible. The job of Marxists, as I'm sure you're gathering at this point, is to historicize. With this in mind, let's discuss some of the specifics of Jameson's framework. First and foremost, the analysis of a text needs to take place within three concentric frameworks, which serve as the semantic horizons of interpretation. Through this process, the critical notion of the text, the object of study, will come to mean something different. Within the narrow confines of the first framework, the political, the text is simply the individual literary work in question. The distinction between this perspective of the text and, say, a formal unpacking is that the text in this instance is understood explicitly as a symbolic act. When the analysis passes through the second framework, the text is opened up to include the realm of the social, in which case, Jameson says, we will find that the very object of our analysis has itself been thereby dialectically transformed, and that it is no longer construed as an individual text or work in the narrow sense, but has been reconstituted in the form of the great collective and class discourses, of which a text is little more than an individual parole or utterance. Look, don't worry about the French stuff, eh? All Jameson is really saying here is the text is one of many things that can be subject to analysis, and achieving any kind of sensible perspective on the text requires a consideration of the broader picture. The world in which the text was produced, other works, other voices, etc. This new horizon, the social, entails an examination of the ideologeme, the, quote, smallest intelligible unit of the essentially antagonistic collective discourses of social classes. The final horizon of interpretive possibility is the historical, human history as a whole. At this level of meaning, the text's ideologemes undergo a final transformation. At this level of meaning, the text is understood in terms of its ideology of form. Ideology of form can be understood as the symbolic messages transmitted to us by the coexistence of various sign systems, which are themselves traces or anticipations of modes of production. I think the way these three various horizons of interpretation work will become more clear when applied to Disco Elysium, so stay tuned for that. Jameson says criticism that is oriented around the question, what does it mean, can be understood as performing an allegorical operation. The function of this operation is to rewrite the text in terms of some master code. All interpretation works this way. Jameson thinks there's no such thing as a non-theoretical practice. Every practice, including literary criticism, necessarily presupposes some theoretical base. Jameson also thinks it's fair to say that the presuppositions by which a method operates constitute in some way the ideology it is attempting to spread. For instance, proponents of new criticism think of it as an ahistorical approach. They consider historical context to be outside the scope of a textual analysis. Yet, it does operate with a particular understanding of history. How could it be otherwise? To quote Jameson, indeed, no working model of the functioning of language, the nature of communication, or of the speech act, and the dynamics of formal and stylistic change is conceivable, which does not imply a whole philosophy of history. Jameson would even say that the function of new criticism is to perpetuate its own ideological understanding of history. The same is true of myth criticism. It was just the other day that Ivanka Trump quoted Joseph Campbell in her commencement speech at WSU Tech.
Joseph Campbell, a philosopher who also helped inspire the creation of Star Wars, once said, "The achievement of the hero is one that he is ready for. It's really a manifestation of his character. The landscape and conditions of the environment match the readiness of the hero. The adventure that he's ready for is the one that he gets." Throughout our history, brave men and women have faced daunting challenges, and they have embraced the adventure. America's fate is never dictated by fear. Our future is written by the love and the courage of our citizens. No person will be unchanged from living through this present hardship. But I am confident that the bonds between us will be stronger. Our admiration for each other will be deeper. Our gratitude for the gift of life will be ever new. And our resolve to build an even brighter future will be greater than ever before. Good luck and God bless.
I would argue that there has always been a reactionary element of myth criticism, with its lack of a historical focus and its prizing of the individual hero. That is precisely why someone like Ivanka Trump can quote Joseph Campbell without missing a beat. For the record, the United States is far more akin to the Empire in Star Wars than most would be comfortable admitting, but I digress. Jameson argues that the conception of interpretation presupposes mechanisms of mystification or repression, at least insofar as they seek to find some latent meaning behind the text. The layperson often claims that a given text simply means what it says. I can't tell you how many times I've gotten comments to that effect in response to my videos. The thing is, we live in a society of mystification and information overload, and if texts were really transparent, no ideology would be possible. We'd live in a society without domination. We very obviously don't live in such a world. Therefore, it makes sense to try and parse the ideology of texts. Jameson's approach should not be conflated with deconstruction or, more generally, a post-structural approach, which often takes on an anti-Marxist character. And on a related note, Jameson does warn the reader about overstressing certain dimensions of the text. To overstress the extent to which the text makes use of its subtext, and thus conclude that the referent does not exist, is a mistake. This is, in all likelihood, a dig at Derrida and the deconstructionists, who claim there is no outside text. But it's also a mistake to overemphasize the extent to which the text reflects actual social conditions. You know, this is a pitfall perhaps I've fallen into, but by doing so, Jameson thinks you run the risk of reifying what is, in all likelihood, not a comprehensive historical truth per se. You end up reifying a contingency. In Jameson's view, both of these extremes are in error and likely to result in sheer ideology. This is why the historical is Jameson's third and all-encompassing horizon of interpretation. By putting a given observation in the context of a class discourse, which is then situated in a broad historical framework, you can correct for certain ideological predilections. One thing in particular I appreciate about Jameson is his understanding of interpretation as a historical process all its own, something to be honed and recontextualized time and time again, but also something that does have clear parameters. Additionally, Jameson's view on artistic interpretation is something that I find to be on the ball, specifically when he says, "I happen to feel that no interpretation can be effectively disqualified on its own terms by a simple enumeration of inaccuracies or omissions, or a simple list of unanswered questions. Interpretation is not an isolated act, but it takes place within a Homeric battlefield on which a host of interpretive options are either openly or implicitly in conflict." The following is a very rudimentary application of Jameson's approach, and I am in no way suggesting this is the definitive Jamesonian approach to analyzing Disco Elysium. With that said, let's get going. In Jameson's understanding of the first horizon of interpretation, the narrowly political level, history is boiled down to the, quote, chronicle-like annals of the rise and fall of political regimes and social fashions. In this framework, the text as a symbolic act is central. At this level, the individual narrative is to be understood as the imaginary resolution of a real contradiction. Cops kneeling with protesters is a perfect example of this. It's a symbolic gesture which, being as charitable as possible towards the individuals involved, seeks to overcome the contradictory relationship between the repressive state apparatus and the public at large. At any rate, we can look at works of art in this same way. Ideology is not something that simply informs symbolic production. Rather, the aesthetic act is manifestly ideological. The function of art in this sense is to concoct imaginary, perhaps even fantastical solutions to the irreconcilable contradictions of class society. Jameson says, "Our discovery of a text's symbolic efficacy must be oriented by a formal description which seeks to grasp it as a determinate structure of still properly formal contradictions." Following Jameson's framework, we then have to understand the resolution of Disco Elysium first in terms of its symbolic significance. In other words, we need to come to terms with the individual text as a symbolic act before we conceptualize it within the broader discourse. It's not sufficient to simply identify class motifs in the game. We need to answer the question, what contradictions does the work seek to resolve in a symbolic fashion? To answer that, we will first take a look at the interior world of the protagonist. Who is the detective? Harry Dubois, Raphael Ambrosius Cousteau, Tequila Sunrise, or all of the above? After all, these monikers are simply the options provided in an endless series of identities to which the good detective can possibly adhere. Identity in Disco Elysium is a direct function of both circumstance and material coercion. And what about agency? How much control does one really have? The important thing to note when it comes to agency in the game is that you are always confined to the larger structures. The imperative of Wild Pines to make a profit, the institution of the RCM, the RCM's mandate from the Coalition, and of course the Union's sphere of influence in Revachol. At numerous points, your consciousness is described as a machine, and interestingly, your character's limbic system takes on a mind of its own. There's a certain point towards the very beginning of the game where you have the option to ask about a certain X, and if you do so, the limbic system will chime in. It warns of a coming awareness, a mass, which it describes as bloated and shameful. It says, "This is a terrible line of questioning, and it will only lead to more awareness of the meat thing. It's you. Your brain hates itself. It hates being alive." Now, it's important to ask at this point, what's with this self-hatred? Why does Harry feel this way? For starters, being a detective certainly takes its toll. A common theme in the work seems to be the use of certain narrative tropes to help cope with the everyday horrors of the job. There's very much a neo-noir-esque vibe to the whole thing. And then there's this strange emphasis on procedure. The autopsy scene in particular is long and very detailed. Another thing I appreciate is not every case is wrapped up as neatly as the one that occupies the main action of this story. Sometimes the best you can do is help a working class woman identify her husband's corpse. Recall the robust yet literary naming convention the detective uses to track his cases. It's not alphabetical or anything like that. It's titular, as in like movie or book titles. Among the detective's cases, the Square Bullet Hole Murders, the Next World Mural, and the Unsolvable Case. We are told this is an informal practice among officers in the RCM. As Kim notes, it's a holdover from the early days of the RCM, right after the Revolution, when the organization had little idea how to do things. Kim's explanation betrays a certain story being told all its own, a fast and loose ideological history of the RCM. Kim seems to view this literary naming convention as antiquated and unprofessional. The official naming convention, alphanumeric, officer, precinct, time of arrival at the scene, implies a gradual standardization of RCM practices over time, a sort of professionalization. Officers of the RCM even perform field autopsies. Yet Kim notes that the powers of the RCM are really quite limited. The RCM mostly imposes fines, limited to 1,000 real. We're not really supposed to play any part in the economic structure of Revachol, says Kim. Additionally, the RCM doesn't convict anyone of offenses, rather, it sends them to the coalition government courts. Eventually, the detective comes to learn that he had previously been taking on 2 cases a week, an extremely heavy caseload by Kim's estimation. In fact, the detective's ledger indicates that he's closed over 200 cases. He's also killed 3 people, a fairly tame number, again, by Kim's estimation. Note that in this world, it's fairly normal for an officer in the RCM to have a number of kills throughout their career. If 3 is fairly low, just imagine how many people the average RCM officer has killed. So I think it's abundantly clear that there are certain things, perhaps a great many things, the protagonist might not want to remember. Things he's seen, things he's done. Though, however, confined to the structural role of the RCM Dubois may be, our protagonist is simply a mystery-solving machine. But is the RCM a force for good in the world? Have the detective's case-solving abilities gone towards a worthy cause? The Revachol Citizens Militia is the, quote, de facto law enforcement in Revachol. Though, per Kim, the scope of their authority is quite limited. According to the Wild Pines rep, Joyce Messier, the RCM acts in the twilight of international law. The coalition government seems to be managing the decline. The Hardy Boys are hostile to the detective for a reason. As Elizabeth says, "Listen, you moral intern lackey, you're a part of a mob enforcing the unlawful privatization of Revachol. 20 fat men in the Occident are stealing it all, and you are their bodyguard." It's fairly clear that the institution known as the RCM is something akin to the police here in the US. A lot of the thematic tension in the work is due to the fact that you often have to ignore or suppress the impulse to be humane in order to, you know, do your job. And when you do voluntarily take on a praiseworthy task, it's totally outside the scope of your duties as an RCM officer. And, well, let's say you want to be a moral agent, an all-around good boy. Let's say you choose the communist route.
Now we're talking.
Well, a lot of good that does you. The game even suggests that being a communist is a detriment to your well-being due to the fact that you see reaction everywhere. That one hits a bit too close to home. No one wants to admit it, but Goth Teletubbies has a reactionary element to it. Suffice it to say that if you go the communist route, you risk becoming something akin to the old revolutionary stuck on that island. And whenever you advocate for communism, people just kind of shrug it off because you're a cop. It's an absurd thing to be a communist whose day job is to uphold the capitalist order. In fact, it's more acceptable for you to be an alcoholic than it is to be a communist, which It's pretty funny when you think about it. This, I believe, is the sense in which Jameson uses terms like ideological closure in Political Unconscious. There are structural elements in society which often confine people to certain perspectives, and the economic base of a given system has a lot to do with that. In the words of Upton Sinclair, it is difficult to get a man to understand something when his salary depends on his not understanding it. Now apply this insight to the current situation in the US, in which demands to defund the police are met with tepidness and empty platitudes by liberal mayors. But now we're really brushing up on the second horizon of Jameson's interpretive approach, the social. And before we fully delve into that, we're going to need to discuss the primary contradiction this work is seeking to resolve. At its core, what is this game really about? As stated, the game takes place in the midst of a strike. The dock workers are attempting to get seats on the board of directors with the ultimate goal of taking over Wild Pines entirely. Martinez might appear to be a run-down garbage town, but it's actually an important terminal in this world. According to Messier, the port in Martinez is responsible for 8% of Elysium's cargo. Additionally, Messier says, Wild Pines started as an exploration and cargo fleet between the Sumerian and Insulinian Isolas. 250 years ago, when the Pines ships explored the South Seamanese and charted Lo Man Thang on behalf of the suzerain. Basically, the company has its roots in colonial rule. Let's also note that Wild Pines has eyes all over Martinez. The company has even brought in mercenaries to handle the strike. Towards the beginning of the game, it would appear that the strike has been met with protesters, would-be scabs attempting to assert their right to work. The scab leader is a big guy who doesn't seem on the level. He claims to be a simple worker, but his background evokes suspicion from the detective. Later, you find out he's part of a band of mercenaries sent there by Wild Pines to put a stop to the strike. Everard Clare, one of the leaders of the union, actually seems to be pleased with the fact that scabs have shown up to protest the strike. Perhaps this demonstration helps him in some way. Importantly, Clare relays he is completely aware of Wild Pine's effort to shut down the strike by sending in armed mercenaries. Their actions have only enabled the union to consolidate support. Clare's office is a large industrial container, which, on the occasion that he needs to travel, is unceremoniously shipped to the desired location. He's propped up by an elaborate series of wooden pallets. This is perhaps the most on-the-nose depiction of a corrupt union boss that I've come across. One might even say that Everard and his brother have established a type of labor aristocracy in which the union operates in Martinez to the detriment of all non-union entities in the region. Messier is oddly forthcoming, and one gets the sense that she's in way over her head, although perhaps that's just what she wants you to think. Messier admits that the mercenaries were sent in for the specific purpose of intimidation. She also expresses concern that the strike will end in a bloodbath. She says, "I'm afraid this strike may descend into a small-scale civil war, with possible consequences for all of Revachol West." According to Messier, my employer experienced a momentary lapse of faith in me. In that moment, they elected to deploy a private military contractor as an insurance measure. They called it my security detail. Interestingly, she notes, they were later dispatched after I relayed the union's initial offer. As we know, the union demanded that each worker be appointed to the board of directors. Essentially, they're aiming to turn the whole operation into a worker co-op. Wild Pines is trying to scare the union into capitulating. There is a lot of ambiguity surrounding the strike. Its impetus is not entirely clear. Clare attributes it to a series of mistakes on the part of Wild Pines, and yet he later alludes to a conspiracy-peddling crypto-fascist writing an article that, as it turns out, has at least a small element of truth to it. Or at least, that's what Clare implies. Specifically, he says, what if he took a whack in the dark, started telling people the strike is funded by a protection racket that drove local shops out of business? You're only given this information after having performed a special task for Clare, which is to break into said crypto-fascist residence. This is an intimidation tactic intended to signal to the fascists that the union has control of the local police. So both the union and Wild Pines are making use of coercive tactics. That much is clear. And Claire's beef with the crypto-fascist is less driven by broad ideology than it is an immediate cutthroat business matter. This person is attempting to postulate a narrative that cuts against the union's interests. Let's also note that Claire tolerates racists within his ranks. Case in point, the character known as Measurehead. In reference to Measurehead, Claire says, "Between you and me, I'm not a huge fan of his race thing, but the union did not get where we are today by frowning on eccentricity." Measurehead's name is an allusion to the racist pseudoscience known as phrenology. He believes the events referred to as the revolution are literally a human sickness. He tries to make it sound scientific, but his ideas are clearly seeped in ultra-reactionary ideology. But this rhetoric is not limited to racist cranks in the game. In your encyclopedia, the spread of world revolution is referred to as metastasis, as in the spread of cancer. It also reminds me of the book peddler, Faisance, who attributes the strange happening in the so-called doomed commercial area to a horrible curse. As she calls it, a disease eating at the very foundation of the building. According to Faisance, the curse has caused every business in the building to declare bankruptcy. And yet the novelty dice maker says, it's just capitalism. We only hear about tales of success, so it's often surprising to realize how many ventures actually fail. Though the doomed commercial area very well could be a victim of the aforementioned protection racket, which Claire implies is funding the strike. So yeah, shit's complicated. Measurehead isn't the only racist character in the game. Of course, there's Gary the crypto-fascist, and then there's a racist lorry driver who thinks foreigners sell drugs to local junkies and then use it to engage in predatory pricing in the manufacturing sector. Specifically, he says, they know they can't beat us in a fair fight, so they have to get us to weaken ourselves somehow. It's racial sabotage. Racial economic sabotage. Of course, the knowledge we acquire from various other parties indicates that broader economic factors in Martinez have far more to do with its decline than any supposed racial element. Later in the game, you are asked to complete another task for Claire in order to obtain your lost gun. Specifically, you are told to get two people to sign off on a construction project in the village, the rundown area on the other side of the bridge. You have the option to ask Claire what the catch is with the paperwork. He replies, "There was no fine print, Harry, but I do hope that construction noise and limited street access encourages some people to move." After a year of that ruckus, who wouldn't? He's careful to note that once they do move, affordable housing will be available elsewhere. Both Lillianne and the old woman have expressed their desire to stay right where they are, but Claire expresses outrage at the living conditions in this area. He says, "I have big plans for Martinez, and they do not include humans living in those pig sheds on the coast. That land will be used for municipal buildings and commerce." Your empathy kicks in, and as far as you can tell, he's genuine in his desire to reinvigorate the area. Claire's also careful to point out that he's not carrying out this endeavor for the sake of his own glorification. He says, "I'm not a symbolist, Harry. I'm a realist. My statue will be Martinez rebuilt, five-story building complexes, kids off speed, and landowners in Ozone hating me. That will be my statue, and yours. We're doing this together." I'll bracket off the question of whether or not the union's presence is better for Martinez as opposed to the alternative, the unrestrained rule of capital. I'm inclined to say it is, but I don't think there's a definitive answer in the game. It would suffice to say that this work is not a single-minded glorification of unions as a whole. However, it also doesn't quite depict the Debardeurs Union as yet another corrupt power structure on equal grounds with the global capitalist class. Rather, I think it's more accurate to say the union started as a historically contingent, epiphenomenal structure, and its priorities have become more ambitious as broader economic problems have intensified over time. Here, we can come to understand, in visceral terms, the Marxian notion of heightened contradictions in capitalist development. The union was only tolerated because it helped alleviate class tensions while still fundamentally preserving the status quo in this local region. Despite this, the conclusion of the game seems to indicate that the organization may indeed have revolutionary potential. It's just not the utopian ideal we all might hope for. Sometimes people just have to play the cards they're dealt, right? To use an oft-quoted passage from Marx's 18th Brumaire, "Men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past. The tradition of all dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the brains of the living. And just as they seem to be occupied with revolutionizing themselves and things, creating something that did not exist before, precisely in such epochs of revolutionary crisis, they anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service, borrowing from them names, battle slogans, and costumes in order to present this new scene in world history in time-honored disguise and borrowed language. Recall that the lead mercenary was killed by a revolutionary sniper, Yosef, a man out of time. I think it's best to understand the murder upon which the entire story hinges, the magical shot from across the sea, to be a stark awakening of the revolutionary spirit, which is, at the same time, a wistful regression into solipsism. It's an awakening that is paradoxically rooted in jealousy and delusion. Let's keep in mind our sniper has gradually succumbed to the neurotoxic effects of the cryptid. This guy's actions are not gesturing romantically towards some utopian world. However, he's also not simply some deluded old man stuck in the past. It's not as simple as all that. In fact, the old man seems quite lucid at times. When asked to drop his rifle, he initially resists. He says he can only lay down his gun before an enemy commander of corresponding rank. When pressed further, he says, to hell with it. It's a walking stick anyway. It's out of bullets. This guy's not out of his mind. He then says, the future teaches you to be alone. The present, to be afraid and cold. We have to consider the effects of the cryptid in allegorical terms. The delusion here is not rooted in the idea that Yosef still thinks he's a revolutionary. The delusion here is that of losing hope for a better world, and perhaps losing hope in humanity itself. Yosef remained loyal to the commune for 43 years. He lived on an isolated island that entire time, refusing to forget the commune of Revachol, until at some point he lost hope entirely. Yosef says, the material base for an uprising has eroded. The working class has betrayed mankind and themselves. He blames the lack of revolutionary conditions on the people of Revachol. Remarking on the coalition's brutality, he says, the bourgeois are not human. You can't really blame Yosef for thinking these things after all he's been through. After all, the coalition killed everyone he knew. Nonetheless, I feel obligated to note that if reaction has set in, it's precisely in these sentiments. This dim view of humanity is a fundamental component of capitalist realism. It compels one to stop considering the idea that people are capable of making a better world. Therefore, it seems to me that the primary contradiction here is that of capitalist realism, the idea that the market system is the only game in town, that there is no viable alternative to global capitalism. This prevailing ideology is propped up by the ruling class even as capitalism is proving to be completely insufficient in terms of its ability to handle a major catastrophe. The story is seeking to overcome capitalist realism by means of a magic bullet. A nearly impossible shot, which subsequently accelerates the end game of capitalist development, the final stage, i.e., late capitalism. That wraps it up for part one of my analysis of Disco Elysium, but stay tuned for part two, in which we explore Jameson's social horizon as well as his historical horizon in application to this work. And believe me when I say all is not what it seems. Now, if you'd like to support me on a monthly basis, you can do so for as little as $1 a month on patreon.com/nightmaremasterclass. Additionally, I should note that all the music for this video was created by yours truly, and you can buy the digital tracks on nightmaremasterclass.bandcamp.com. I think you can purchase my entire discography for less than $10, so yeah. All right, that wraps it up for this installment of Nightmare Masterclass. Thank you for watching, and good night.